Well, thank you, Eleanor, for the introduction. It's really nice to be here today. It's really nice to see all my colleagues too. It's been way too long, so looking forward to the day. My name's Jack. I'm a PhD candidate at the University of Canberra. I want to acknowledge and thank my supervisors, first of all, Professor Diane Gleeson and Dr. Elise Ferlin, and also the CISS program for the opportunity today. So to start with just a bit of background introduction, obviously just going to summarise my research today so far. I commenced my PhD in mid-2019, and I'm also a member of the EcoDNA team based at the University of Canberra. And the title of my research so far is Monitoring Urban Biodiversity Using Environmental DNA. And what was interesting was at the time in 2019, there wasn't a huge amount of urban-based research, particularly in the eDNA field. And since that time, in the last 4 years or so, or 3 years, there's been a lot of urban eDNA research, which I find quite interesting, and obviously I wasn't the only one to sort of have this idea, but I also think that urban research is becoming more of a priority across a lot of ecological areas and monitoring areas, and I find that really interesting. And so eDNA seems to fit quite nicely into this urban sphere, and the reason for that is that, sorry, first of all, I should probably define eDNA for you. So I've defined eDNA here as DNA shed by organisms into the environment, into water, soil, or air, and we can infer species presence through the analysis of this captured eDNA. And it just so happens that eDNA has a lot of attributes that make it quite feasible in the urban sphere. For example, it relies on, it's a non-invasive technique, so we don't really need to see the organism. We don't need traps or anything like that. So at the site level and in an urban ecosystem, there's no eyesores or any sort of things that might be off-putting in the urban sphere. The other thing is that kind of goes hand in hand with urban environments is that there's a lot of citizens there in urban environments by definition, and citizen science is a useful data set, obviously, and eDNA has really tapped into that on the back of things like portable workflows where we can conduct fields, whether it's extraction in the field, PCR in the field, and analyse data and return data in a real-time manner. And this goes hand in hand with something like citizen science as well. And the last point there is that our urban environments are hosts to invasive species and endangered species, and eDNA promotes itself as being really useful in monitoring these species because it can detect species when they're in low density or when incursions are just beginning. And so eDNA kind of positions itself as being quite useful in this sphere. So all these things together seem to point to eDNA being quite appropriate in the urban sphere. And as you can see, this is me being a goofball in Sydney, just carrying around my sort of equipment for the day, just taking a nice sample for the next project I'm going to talk about, obviously eDNA has many applications, and this is one that kind of took my fancy, which was to monitor green roof biodiversity. Now, our cities are obviously changing in a way that makes sense for both human and biodiversity interests, and green roofs, although in Australia are quite new, overseas, particularly in places like Europe, they're more established, and the point of them being from an architectural standpoint, they're really interesting in terms of they can improve water efficiency and thermal properties of the building. So engineering-wise, they have really fantastic qualities, but from a biodiversity standpoint, they're often promoted as being useful habitat for biodiversity. And what's interesting here is that when you talk to people about these projects, there seems to be this assumption that a green roof will improve biodiversity, which in a way is kind of a bit strange to talk about, because at first we need to think about, well, what is actually on a green roof. And I seem to feel that eDNA was a really good tool to be able to inform those decisions because, as I just mentioned before, it's non-invasive. I could walk through the middle of Sydney, which is what I'm doing here in Barangaroo, and basically go up to this skyscraper and take a water sample in this case, and return some data. And what I chose to do for this was a term we call eDNA metabarcoding, which is sort of a term to refer to analysis of multiple taxa. And so from a green roof perspective, you might be interested in understanding, say, the temporal aspect of it. So after rainfall, what is a species composition? Or after seasons, what changes? When you take plants out, what happens to the species community? And as you kill things off. And so you can use those data sets to then inform the decisions about, well, what species will we actually like on this green roof other than, for instance, you know, maybe this green roof's just attracting pigeons or something like that, which may not be of actually any use at all to the ecosystem, and those resources could be used somewhere else, like in a park nearby. So the value of eDNA data in this instance is quite high because we can, you know, we could look at something like the soil microbiome through metabarcoding or pollinators. But I really basically just wanted to say, hey, you can just get up and take a sample. And for example, this is just really basic biodiversity, but it is an example of what you could detect on a green roof, whether it's invertebrates or birds that come along and roost. So hopefully pushing forward with analysis of this soon, but I think in principle I really like this idea because I was able to go up and basically say, hey, you can take this really useful data set and make it your own on your own green roof. But like any method, there are challenges to eDNA-based approaches, and I'm just going to focus on two challenges that we find in a lot of our eDNA workflows, and that is that the detection across taxa, so fish make up the majority of eDNA studies, and that's nothing against fish, but it does seem to be that they're more appropriate to detect because they're always contributing eDNA to the environment that makes sense. And the other thing, the other challenge I wanted to highlight here was just that we do a lot of eDNA testing in a sort of a controlled sense. And when we take that to more complex ecosystems and natural ecosystems, that resolution seems to get lost a bit. And the challenge there is really communicating that to end users who want to use eDNA and have a really fantastic idea of what it can do. But ultimately, sometimes when we take it to this kind of natural environment, we lose a lot of that kind of definition. So to illustrate this, I wanted to focus on another aspect of my PhD, which was to monitor a highly urbanized reptile species, in this case, the red-eared slider turtle, which is really notorious. It's a global invasive, and it's really capable of doing quite well in these urban environments. And at the time, I was sort of tasked with surveying for these turtles, there was a lot of hype and media around the use of eDNA to detect these things because, you know, people, end users and agencies had sort of thought that eDNA would be, you know, a silver bullet in some ways and that would be really useful. And I could see why they could think that too. So basically from then on, I went to validated my workflows. So for example, conducted controlled experimental designs, validated assays for it, tested things like citizen science, data sets versus more established methods. And then I took that out to the field and basically went to field sites where there was sort of current occupancy for these turtles, and I found I got really poor detection. And at the time, that was a bit of a setback, but digging into literature, that seemed to be pretty par for the course in terms of detection of a reptile species in this case. So that's really interesting. So we can have these really optimized methods and go to the field, and you get this really sort of really low detection probability for a reptile species. So it kind of begs the question, well, what is the utility of actually these eDNA-based approaches for certain species? In my case, I have a red-eared slider turtle, which is invasive, so we really want to know where it is at the time of incursion. So to detect a low-density species, for example, here we can see, just demonstrate this, we've got a paper here from my supervisor, Elise, which kind of just shows when we have few fish, we need more eDNA samples to detect it with confidence, which is quite logical. But it seems that reptiles have this added complexity in that they're not actually shedding eDNA in a way that makes sense or is inconsistent. So we could theoretically see the turtle and we could theoretically know it's there, but we're not getting that eDNA detection as well. And so that kind of begs the question, well, how appropriate is it for eDNA approaches at all? And are there things we need to think about? So before I move on to sort of that question, we just thought we'd probably wrap up the first part of that research, which was just to kind of say, we can validate things till the cows come home and we can do all this kind of testing and show you that we've got, you know, an ideal scenario. But when we take that kind of mesocosm controlled environment testing to the field, does that really translate and do we need to think about that a bit further? So that begs the question, I guess, can we improve the detection probabilities for something like a turtle or challenging species in this case, and any considerations? And so some researchers have thought, well, you know, obviously not. Is it adequate at all? And I can certainly see where they come from. But the difference here, I think, is that turtles are detectable. It's just they're not doing it in a way that makes sense for typical eDNA sampling strategies. So at a field site, like the one I showed before, really large field site, we might be trying to sample all the water, but none of that DNA is actually aggregated in a sample for detection. So we began to think about this in terms of eDNA availability and strategies to improve those detection probabilities. And one idea we came up with for the turtles anyway was to think about, well, they're going to come out and bask like most turtles do to keep warm and to moderate their metabolism. And so what if we thought about really targeting that eDNA approach to a place where we know that they could be hanging out? And so we thought, well, that's really cool. We could use their pontoons, for example. But then we actually collaborated with Queensland DF and DPI to basically say, well, we need to make sure that when they come out onto these pontoons, they actually leave something behind for detection as well. So we basically fitted these pontoons with like this aluminium metal strip you can see here, and you can see this turtle kind of gripping on. And we've got some sandpaper here as well. And we basically said, hey, can you just swab this pontoon for us? like I've demonstrated here in the photo on the right, and send that back to us, and lo and behold, we got some really cool detection, good detection from it. And while that's, I think that seems kind of simple, you know, turtles obviously bask, in concept I think that articulates a lot of the issues we have with detection of certain challenging taxa anyway, that we're moving it away from just being a passive approach to something that we can incorporate with other field sampling strategies and improving detection probabilities for challenging taxa. So at the moment, we've just kind of pilot tested that, and that seems to be working quite well. So just looking for an experimental design to set that up now, which I think is quite interesting. And yeah, so I think that's all I have today. I think I must have moved very fast there, sorry. I just really want to say a few thank yous before I go. I want to thank, obviously, Diane and my supervisors. I want to thank Alejandro and the EcoDNA team. I want to thank Tony for being a fantastic mentor, and my CISS colleagues. And lastly, I just want to acknowledge a colleague of ours, Bea, who unfortunately passed away a few weeks ago. Great friend, and we miss her lots. But yeah, it's nice to be here today to celebrate. So thank you.